if necessary.
So let me come back to harmonic balance and see if I can explain this in a way that is even more clear than before. And again, I want to do an example because I think it'll be easier if we do a specific example. So I'm going to think of our typical section model, although we could certainly use any other linear model. So that went something like this. If you remember, H and alpha is our plunge and pitch degrees of freedom. K sub H is the stiffness of the plunge spring, and that's equal to minus the lift. And then the other equation motion looks like this. And this is equal to the aerodynamic moment about the elastic axis. And the good news is it really doesn't matter what those are, as long as they are linear. They have a linear relationship to H and alpha and time derivatives of H and alpha, right? So whether we use piston theory aerodynamics or we use Z arrow or whatever, what I'm about to describe still works. And as stated, this is a linear model still, both in the structure on the left-hand side, because all those terms are linear in H and alpha and time derivatives thereof, and the left-hand side by definition. By assumption, they're linear, and lift and moment are linear in H and alpha as well. But then to make this a nonlinear system, because I want to talk about harmonic balance as a way to treat nonlinearities in aerolastic models, I have to add something that makes it nonlinear. And the simplest thing to add is a nonlinear spring, and I'll make it a cubic spring. I could make it quadratic. But for reasons that will become clear later, if not now, I don't want to do that. So I want a nice cubic spring, okay? And then if we are to proceed using harmonic balance, what we're going to do is we're going to assume that H and alpha both go like alpha bar, which we don't know yet, cosine omega t, and we don't know omega yet either. But we're going to determine them with a certain amount of effort. And actually, in some ways, given the fact that this is a nonlinear system, the actual amount of effort is relatively modest, as you'll see. But I think the thing that may be most difficult for someone encountering this for the first time is actually understanding what the manipulations mean physically and how you think about what's going on. Just as an aside, we're going to assume that H goes like cosine omega t, but if there's a phase shift, we'd also have to have a sine and cosine. The reason I don't need a sine here, because this is a self-excited system, and I can choose the phase and time anywhere I like. And it's certainly very convenient since alpha is the one that has the nonlinear part, right? So allow it to be the cosine of omega t and allow H and have a sine and a cosine of omega t. Anyway, okay. Now, the first thing you do is do a standard linear flutter analysis, ignoring this term. That's the first thing you do. And when you do that, for this kind of a system, you get a result that looks like this, where this is the flutter speed. This is the flow speed at which flutter will occur for the linear system. And you can plot this versus lots of things, but since the nonlinearity is in this cubic stiffness term, you really want to plot it versus for the linear case. You want to plot it versus the linear stiffness associated with alpha, namely K alpha. In fact, I'm going to make it K alpha 1 so I can always distinguish it from the other stiffness, right? So this is purely linear theory. If I'm above this boundary, I'm in a flutter regime. If I'm below it, I'm not flutter. Okay? If I'm right on the boundary, the solution is neither growing nor decaying in time. It's what we call neutrally stable. All that's really important. Because now I'm going to blindly assume that I can use the same curve for the nonlinear case. Okay? Except now I don't interpret this as the flutter speed, I interpret it as any speed. And I don't interpret this as K alpha 1, I interpret this as K alpha effective. And what I mean by K alpha effective is, what's happening physically because of this nonlinear strain is that the resonant frequency in torsion, in this case, is changing as a function of the amplitude in alpha. And I can compute that very easily, approximately, to a good approximation, by using harmonic balance. So to use the harmonic balance, I need to do two things. I need to reinterpret this curve. We'll talk more about that in detail, but basically the first thing you have to accept is I'm going to reinterpret this curve, okay? Even though I got it from linear theory, I'm going to use it for the nonlinear model too. And then the other thing I need to do is I need to be able to compute the effective K alpha. But we can do that. How do we do that? Well, we have K1 alpha plus K, okay, alpha 1, plus K alpha 3 alpha cubed. Okay? That's the total stiffness, both linear and nonlinear in alpha. But if I assume, I actually don't need these equations, so I'll just call that equation 1, the one for alpha. And I'll call this, I'm going to write this as K effective times alpha. But K effective is going to be a function of alpha because it's a nonlinear system, right? So I need to figure out what K effective is. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to take equation 1 and put it in equation 2 and compute K effective. Right? So if I put 1 in 2, what do I get? I get K alpha 1 cosine omega t plus K alpha 3, there's an alpha bar here, that's important. Right? Shouldn't leave that out. Alpha bar. Plus K alpha 3 alpha bar cubed cosine cubed omega t equals K alpha effective times alpha, which is alpha bar cosine omega t, right? Okay. But this, from a trigonometric identity, okay, this is 3/4 cosine omega t plus 1/4 cosine 3 omega t, right? And I'm going to throw away the cosine 3 omega t term because I don't like it. I'm offended, no. I'm going to throw it away because I have no way of balancing it. I don't have a cosine 3 omega t on this side. Now, if I want a cosine 3 omega t on that side, I can get one. But there's a price to pay, which I care not to pay. I would have to go back here and put in another term, which is cosine 3 omega t. And then I would go through this process again, and I would now have both cosine omega t and cosine 3 omega t on both sides, and I could balance those. But it would turn out that because I have a cosine 3 omega t up here and I put it in here, that will also generate a cosine 5 omega t, and then I have to throw that away. So I can never completely catch up. But the thought is that the higher harmonics and whatever coefficient multiplies the harmonics are going to be smaller than the first harmonic. Or if you insist, the first and third harmonic are going to be dominant, and the fifth, seventh, ninth. It turns out that only the odd harmonics appear because I've got an odd power of alpha. Okay. Are you with me? Thank you. Very good. So if I do all that, then this term becomes 3/4 cosine omega t plus the other stuff that I don't care about, right, which I'm throwing away involves 3 omega t. And then I cancel out all the cosine omega t's, right? I can cancel out one part, one alpha, that makes this alpha squared, right? And now I have an expression for 8K alpha effective. And it is, are you ready? Okay. It is K alpha effective is equal to, what is it? It's K alpha 1 plus K alpha 3 times 3 quarters times alpha bar squared. It's only squared because I cancel out the alpha bar in all the terms, right? Okay, so this K effective depends on the amplitude of the oscillation. If the amplitude of the oscillation, if alpha bar is really small, strictly speaking zero, I'm just going to retrieve the flutter condition from this procedure. But beyond that, I can actually get some limit cycle oscillation information. In particular, I can determine alpha bar as a function of U. So how do we do that? Thank you for asking. Remember what I'm doing now. I have a plot of U, infinity, versus K effective. And I claim it looks like this, which it does. Okay. And maybe in a moment I'll explain why. I think I've actually told you why it has a minimum, but I'll talk about that a little bit later. Okay. But this, remember what this is. I also have a plot of, I could also plot K effective versus alpha bar, right? And remember what K effective? Well, here it is. Yeah, right? First of all, for alpha bar equals zero, it's just K alpha 1, right? And then as alpha bar increases, K effective increases in a parabolic way, right? It looks like that. The point is it never goes down. It always goes up. And goes up like alpha bar squared. Okay. Now, what I really want to get is a plot of alpha bar versus U infinity. But both of them depend on K effective. So if I choose a K effective, I can compute alpha bar on the one hand and U infinity on the other hand, and then I can plot U infinity versus alpha bar, and I'm done. It might be convenient in that respect to take this plot. I'll call this plot Roman number 1, this plot Roman number 2. I might want to, rather than plot it this way, I might want to reverse the axis, right, and plot it this way. So here I'll put an alpha bar up here, like it, and K effective down here. And remember what happens when alpha bar is 1, I'm at K alpha 1. And then as alpha bar increases, K effective increases this way. I mean, this is just this curve with the axis rotated 90 degrees, right? Ah, are you still with me? Okay. So, now what we're going to do is we're going to assume that we have a linear system initially, but then it's going to have a little nonlinearity in just a moment. So, I want to pick the flutter point that corresponds to K alpha 1, right? I mean, K alpha 1 is the linear stiffness. And foolishly, I asked Kevin to tell me whether, last time, whether I wanted to be on this side of the curve or this side. Remember that? And in a weak moment, I agreed to be on this side of the curve. And we will go to this side of the curve, but it'll be easier to explain this if I start on this side of the curve. Okay. You got me into big trouble, but I forgive you. Okay. So I'm going to think of this as being some nominal K alpha 1. K alpha 1 nominal. Okay. So here's my flutter. This is a flutter velocity. All right. But for a given K alpha 1, there's a point on this curve. There's a velocity which is the flutter velocity, right? Even for the nonlinear system, it's still the flutter velocity. It's the velocity where, in this case, if I'm below that, the system is stable, and if I'm above that, the system is unstable. Okay. But now, and that corresponds on to really taking this point, right? Or if you prefer, this point on this curve, right? I'm looking at really small alpha, which corresponds to the onset of flutter, and therefore the onset of the limit cycle. Okay, but now as alpha bar increases, I go up this curve. I go up this curve, and K effective increases. If K effective increases, that means I go up this curve. So I go, I don't know, up here and up here, right? And now I have a certain alpha bar. I'll put an X on it. Don't even know I'm talking about that, please. And I have a certain use of X, okay? And then I go up this curve a bit further. I'll call that 0.0. So I go up here, okay? Okay? And so I just keep plotting these points. This is the flutter point. This corresponds to alpha bar equals 0. This is a higher velocity at which alpha bar has some non-zero value. And this is yet a higher point at a higher velocity with a higher alpha bar, right? So there's a monotonic relationship. Alpha bar goes up, U goes up. Okay? So if I keep doing that, I'll get a plot that looks like this. Here's alpha bar. I could plot the other way around. I can rotate the axis 90 degrees if you prefer, but here's the flutter velocity. That could be obtained from purely linear theory. But then I have these other points. Now this is the LCO response. And this tells me once I go beyond the flutter velocity, how big alpha bar will be as a function of velocity. And I'm done. Now you don't need to use harmonic balance to get that information. You could go back to the original differential equations of motion and use whatever aerodynamic theory you like, right? And do a time march using Runge-Kutta or some other value. You could do that and get the same answer, nearly the same answer. Actually, presumably it would be a slightly better answer because, remember, we're throwing away higher harmonics in this approximation. But if you use Z arrow, you're never going to get there. Why? Z arrow, strictly speaking, only works for harmonic motion at a single frequency, right? So I can use this method with Z arrow to get the limit cycle. I can't use time marking with Z arrow without doing some other thing. Actually, there is a way to take the frequency domain aerodynamics and try to convert it into a model that works in the time domain, but that involves some further approximation. That's a lot more work than doing what I just did. Okay. So this is the easiest way to get to a good answer. Not a perfect answer, but a good answer. Are you still with me? Now we're going to pause for questions, because then we'll do the hard case that Kevin likes so much. Yes?
On the last page you had, with the plus infinity effect, when you increase the stiffness and you go up this curve, are you saying
which curve do you want to be on? This curve, this one, or this one?
Top
one, okay. Top one.
So UF isn't increasing.
Okay, here's the flutter velocity, right? And that corresponds to a very small value of alpha bar, which means that the K effective is essentially K alpha 1, right?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay.
I'm just wondering, it looks like the flutter velocity will effectively be increasing if you sway to a
It's not really the flutter velocity, but here's the relationship between what I'll call the limit cycle velocity and the flutter velocity. And I'm glad you asked that question. There is a relationship. There's a more general concept. Both flutter and limit cycles are neutrally stable oscillations. What do I mean by that? If I'm right on this curve, which I eventually get, right? If I'm right on this curve and I give the system a small perturbation, a small disturbance, it will oscillate, but it will return to this curve. Remember what this curve is. This curve itself is an oscillation. So let me draw a picture. Let me draw a picture of alpha bar cosine omega t, right? Meaning alpha bar is some constant, right? It depends on flow velocity. That's a constant. Doesn't change the time. So if I plot this versus time, of course, I just get a cosine oscillation, right? And I get that, according to this analysis, I get that anywhere along this curve. But of course, alpha bar changes, but it's still all a sinusoid. But now if I disturb the system, if I kick the system, then it'll go away from this curve, but it'll soon come back to it. And that'll be true whether I kick it up or kick it down. So all of these points along this curve are neutrally stable oscillations, and since when I perturb the system, it comes back to this curve. This is unlike the linear system. In a linear system, if I had a purely linear system, then K effective never changes. Okay, K, if I set K alpha 3 to 0 and I tried to use the same method, I'd just get a vertical curve. That's all I get. And linear theory says once I proceed beyond this flutter velocity, the steady state oscillation is infinite. But with the nonlinearity, it's not infinite. This curve bends over from the vertical. Does that help? Sort of? A little bit?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's not because the LCO velocity is not the flutter velocity.
Yeah, I would call it the LCO velocity. You could call it the neutrally stable oscillation velocity. That's a long check. And people are, of course, accustomed to identifying this as flutter. It's really interesting. And back in the old days being less than 20 years ago, when I would give talks like this, people thought that LCO was one thing and flutter was something else, and they had no particular relationship. Well, now it was always obvious that someone who understood non-dynamics was related. But a lot of people in the flutter world weren't prepared to think about that. So when people started drawing pictures like this and explaining why flutter and LCO really had an intimate relationship, that was a great revelation.
Not that long ago.
Okay, other questions?
So do you think to the right of the LCO response is like a diverge?
If I'm over here or to over here?
Yeah.
No.
As you go from left to right.
This curve tells me, and maybe someday you will agree with this, this curve tells me if I go above the flutter velocity, which is this velocity, I would just march up this curve. So if I were in the wind tunnel, and I kept increasing the flow velocity beyond this point, I would just see a larger and larger oscillation, a larger and larger amplitude oscillation. Now, I haven't drawn this, but there's all, you know, I told you there was a flutter velocity curve, a curve like this. There's also a curve you get out of linear flow analysis, which tells you how the frequency of the oscillation changes along this curve, right? So I can also, using the same method and a similar curve for the frequency, I can also tell you how the frequency changes. Now, it turns out for a system like this, the frequency of the limit cycle oscillation is very close to the frequency of the flutter. In fact, sometimes people make the approximation in doing the calculation that I don't need to bother to separately compute the LCO frequency because it's so close to the flutter frequency. But you can also use this method to compute a change in frequency. Okay? Now are we ready to do the hard case? All right, I'll do the hard case. See, this is page 3. Okay, let's go back to my curve here, where this is now U infinity versus K effective. And the curve looks like something like this, okay? And then I also want to draw, again, alpha bar as a function of K effective. Remember what that looks like? That goes like this, all right? Alpha bar, K effective always increases with alpha bar for this particular example. Now, there are curves where this curve goes the other way, and that's another story, which I'm not telling you at the moment. But I am going to tell you that there's a big difference between whether I start over here in terms of my nominal linear system versus starting over here. And we've just discussed starting over here, but now we want to start over here. The important thing to note is the following. When K effective goes up, alpha bar goes up. And conversely, when alpha bar goes up, K effective goes up. So if this is my nominal flutter point, with some K alpha 1. Okay. But now it's a smaller K alpha 1 than for this case, right? I'm down on this point of the curve. Now, when alpha bar goes up and I'm moving along what I'll call the LCO curve, K alpha, K effective is going up. So I'm now moving this away and this away. And then eventually I get to the minimum, right? Wherever that is. And then I'm learning out the symbols here. And then I started going back up again. Okay? So now, as alpha bar is increasing initially, U is decreasing. And then I reach a minimum U, and then it starts increasing again, all the while alpha bar is increasing. So now, if I plot alpha bar versus U infinity, I need a bigger screen. Let me go back here. What I want to do is the following. Okay, I know this corresponds to alpha bar equals 0. And then this is a bigger alpha bar, but that's a lower U. And then that's the lower U. And then I reach a minimum. And then I start going back up again. So what does that mean? Here's my nominal U flutter that corresponds to K alpha effective equal to K alpha 1, right? So now as alpha bar increases from here, U is going down. So I'm going down and down, and then it goes down further, and I reach a minimum in U, and then I start going back up. So the curve looks like this. And then once I get beyond this minimum, it just keeps going up like before. So the curve looks like this. Okay? And that's more difficult than the other curve, right? The other curve, it just went up, right? Now it goes down, then goes back up. So there's a minimum, there's an alpha bar corresponding to the minimum velocity, flow velocity, at which a neutrally stable oscillation will occur. If I'm the chief engineer and I want to be conservative, I want to design to that minimum flow velocity, right? Because I might get there. I might get there. But now, having said that, what does this part of the curve mean and what does that part of the curve mean? Harmonic balance doesn't tell you, but the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem does, almost. Or a lot of experience tells you. Remember what linear theory says. Linear theory says I stay right on this axis until I hit this point. And then the linear system becomes dynamic and unstable. It turns out that this portion of the curve is a rough measure of how big I have to kick the system to get it to go into a neutrally stable oscillation. If I kick at a small amount, I will oscillate in a transient, but come back to zero. Okay? If I kick it a large enough amount to get up in this region, I may jump up to this part of the curve. Okay? If I stay with a small oscillation and I kick the system just a small amount, I can go right up here before I get into trouble. But once I hit this point, it wants to flutter. And according to linear theory, I go to infinity, of course. But according to nonlinear theory, I just jump up to here. And then if I keep increasing flow velocity, I follow this curve. Right? What happens if I come back down? Remember, I'm now doing a windfall experiment. Right? I'm really closely controlling my disturbances. In the windfall, I'll go right up here. And then when I hit this, it'll jump up to a big amplitude, and I'll get excited because I might break my model. And then I keep going up. But then now I dial the flow velocity back down. I go all the way back down this curve to this minimum point. I can't go any further, right? So then I jump back down to zero. And it turns out that this portion of the curve is a neutrally stable oscillation, but it's unstable in the sense that if I give it a small perturbation, I either jump back down to here or I jump up to here. Harmonic balance doesn't tell you that. You have to either have some experience, you have to know about the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, which says basically stable and unstable limit cycles alternate. This is one stable limit cycle, the small perturbations. This is another stable limit cycle, therefore the one in between has to be unstable. And the Bendixson theorem only applies to a very restricted class of dynamical systems. But we assume that engineers, not mathematicians, I mean Poincaré and Bendixson are mathematicians, so they're still working on developing the theorem for large number of degrees of freedom. God bless them. But people who deal with large number of degrees of freedom routinely assume that even though this theorem only, strictly speaking, works for a small number of degrees of freedom, it still works at least qualitatively for any number of degrees of freedom. Right? It's like Fermi's theorem, right? How long did it take them to... People knew this truth for a long time, and it took about 300 years for somebody to prove it. So someday somebody will prove this. But in the meantime, we know it's true. We think it's true. We're more confident of this than we are of most things in life. That this is true. Yeah. Okay.
Will you get the solution in the time marching
approach? You can time march. And if you do time, and we've done this, if you time march, what happens is what I just said. In fact, that's the way you know this is what I said. It's really true, you time march. But you can only time march, as I explained, if you use some approximations to the aerodynamic, right? You have to use it. And you can only time march in practice from the standpoint of computational cost if it's a relatively small number of degrees of freedom. But, yeah, for this example, you could certainly time march. When you time march, you find out what I just said. Namely, if I give this a small kick, it oscillates and comes back to zero. But if I'm beyond this minimum point and I give it a big enough kick, I jump up to here. And certainly by the time I get to here, I jump up to here, right? And if I jump up to here and go up, I go up this curve. And then if I'm on this curve and I now dial back the velocity in my time simulation, the flow velocity in my time simulation, I'll go all the way back to here. But once I get there, I got to go someplace. The only place I can go is back down to here. That's the only possible solution. So the time marching solution is consistent with what I've just said. Okay. I've got one more thing I want to say about harmonic balance, but let's take questions first.
So how do you know where your chaos starts?
Oh, well, you have to tell me what the system is. I mean, you have to tell me what kind of spring you got. Yeah. I mean, someone has to characterize the stiffness of the structure. So I either have a nonlinear structural model of some sort, or I go into the laboratory and apply a static load and see how it deforms and infer what the coefficients are, K alpha 1, K alpha 3. Yeah, someone has to give me, either from experiment or some nonlinear theory, K alpha 1 and K alpha 3. Yeah, absolutely. But once you tell me K alpha 1, I know whether I'm over here, and then I do my thing. Okay. Other questions? Yes, sir. Alpha bar equals zero corresponds to the flutter velocity, yes.
Yeah. So we've got K alpha that we did in the previous stage when it was higher, it was alpha bar gradually increasing
the velocity, and that's when you get like a something else. I think I understood your question. Let me go back to here. Okay. This curve came from using harmonic balance, but it's a good approximation to reality. You could get the same information from experiment or time march or something. But this tells me how the effective stiffness is a function of how large the amplitude of oscillation is, right? If the amplitude of oscillation is very small, I'm here, and that corresponds to K alpha 1. Then if I were doing an experiment, for example, and try to find K alpha 3, what I would do is I would take some data along this curve from some static experiment and see if for a given choice of K alpha 3, I could mimic pass a curve through those experimental data. Does that?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, like, in practice, can have any limits like this magnitude by gradually.
Tell me that one more time.
Flutter being at the flutter point, there's no limit cycle.
Well, it's a very small amplitude limit cycle. I mean, you can think of flutter as the limit of the limit cycle as the amplitude of the limit cycle is at zero. Okay?
But when we have K alpha 1 from the fire side, the left side, it's a big jump suddenly to a higher.
There could be, yeah. That's right. There could be. And if you're on, if you're over here, if you start over here, you start over here in the sense that that's where the flutter velocity is, which is this. Then if you start over here, this says that when I'm doing a wind tunnel test or a calculation, if I'm very careful and don't disturb the system very much, so I can march right up to the flutter point without getting up here. By the time I get here, I'm really going to experience a big jump. So this system has a much more dramatic limit cycle behavior than if you start on this side of the curve. And this side of the curve, you just have a gradual increase, right? You get into a little, you're in a small amplitude limit cycle, and the whole velocity goes up and it gets bigger and bigger. It's a benign case. In fact, there are names for this. This is called a subcritical limit cycle because it happens below the flutter speed, and the other case is a supercritical. Or sometimes people call this a benign, this a dangerous limit cycle, right? And the other case, a benign limit cycle. I mean, it's much better to get in a limit cycle where as you increase the flow velocity, the amplitude just grows smoothly as the flow velocity increases. If you get in a situation where the amplitude is quite small, maybe oscillating because there's a little randomness in the flow or something, but it's really basically zero. And then you suddenly jump into a large oscillation. That's probably something you'd like to avoid in a real airplane or even in a wind tunnel. Unless you're doing research on that, and in which case you think that's great because it's research. But you still want to make sure you don't break the law. Okay? Okay. Now, let's do an easier case, he said slightly. I did alpha cubed, right? Well, why not do alpha squared? Why did I jump from alpha to alpha cubed? Why not alpha squared? Well, you'll see why in a moment. So let's go back. And now we're going to have K alpha 1 alpha plus K alpha 2 alpha squared equals K effective times alpha, right? I guess. And we can play the same game. We can let alpha equal alpha bar cosine omega t. So this is K alpha 1 alpha bar cosine omega t. Was K alpha T, alpha bar cosine omega T squared equals K alpha, K effective. Alpha, I guess it puts alpha times alpha bar cosine omega T. Someone has to tell me, I know you have this at your fingertips, right? What's cosine squared? I never remember it myself. Doesn't matter. I almost remember. What is it, cosine squared from your trip? Yeah, it's either 1 plus or minus cosine 2 omega t over 2. I never remember. But I don't remember which one it is. It doesn't matter for our purposes. One of those. Look it up in your trigonometric handbook. Well, I got a problem, I think. Hey, I just got cosine omega t over here. Over here, I got cosine omega t, but here I got 1, which is cosine 0 omega t, right? And cosine 2 omega t. Can't balance. Can't do it. And but this is trying to tell us something. Usually when you get a well, I shouldn't be too optimistic, but often enough that you should think about it. When something like this happens, you gotta say, well, what is it trying to tell me? What it's trying to tell you is that this kind of nonlinearity is going to give a static zero frequency effect. So what I really need to do is go back probably, and rather than assuming alpha equals alpha bar cosine omega t, what I probably need to do is let alpha equal alpha bar static cosine zero omega t, right? Plus alpha bar dynamic cosine omega t, and have at it. So in this case, I can't get away with just one harmonic. That's the point. I really have two harmonics. I have the one that I thought I wanted plus something else. Maybe I need the cosine two omega t term, right? You'd have to play with it. So there can be cases where as wonderful as this is, it doesn't always work. But this would be unusual. This would be an unusual kind of spring, because what does it say? It says the sign of the applied force, the sign of the relationship between the deflection alpha and a static force, the nonlinearity is independent of the sign of the applied force, which is unlikely, right? Unlikely in reality. So the cube case is actually physically the more interesting case. But if you had something like this, you might have a problem. And I will point out to you another example similar to this, and that's transonic flow. I know you all remember the transonic small disturbance equation. Well, final exam's coming up. By the way, the final exam is going to be open book. You can bring anything to the final exam you like, except a consulting expert. You can bring notes, books, whatever you want. But so when I ask you about the transonic small disturbance equation, you it would be helpful if you actually knew what the page to look at, right? And you can't spend the entire hour looking for the page for transonic equation. That's not fair. But the equation looked like something like this. Remember, there was a phi sub xx term. And then there was something, I think it was something like 1 minus m infinity squared, you remember this, times gamma plus 1 times phi sub x, and then there were other terms, right? In the transonic small disturbance equation, the nonlinearity is quadratic. It is quadratic. Now, this is quadratic in the velocity potential. And this is a harder case for lots of reasons, including the fact that now the nonlinearity is in a partial different equation, which depends on space and time. So the nonlinearity is throughout space, right? the nonlinear terms depend on x, y, and z as well as t. Whereas in the case we did just a moment ago, it was only nonlinear in time, which makes a much easier case. And physically, in one case, we have sort of a concentrated nonlinearity, namely it's in that spring, right? It's concentrated in that spring. Here it's distributed throughout the fluid. So there are a lot of reasons why this is a harder problem to deal with. But it's also an example just like this. If I take phi, a function of x, y, z, and t, and write it as phi bar of x, y, and z times, say, cosine omega t, just for this reason alone, and because it's a quadratic nonlinearity, I'm going to run into the same problem. And what it is telling me something physical. It's telling me that in transonic flow, it's really the change in the mean flow, the static part of the flow, if you will, the part that doesn't depend on time, even before the airflow begins to move, which is a significant contributor to the nonlinearity. And that's why a few days ago, I said, well, why don't we let it be a phi static, which only depends on x, y, and z, plus a phi dynamic, which depends on x, y, z, and t, and we'll solve a nonlinear problem with the static part, and then we'll substitute the whole thing in and retain only a linear part that belongs to the feed dynamic and help get a good answer. And what that will tell us physically is that the static part of the solution, which will depend on the shape of the airfoil and the amount of other things, it will influence just the flutter point. Because by linearizing this, all I'll ever be able to compute is the flutter point. I won't be able to compute a limit cycle. It also tells us that potential flow models, I'm probably inferring more. I'm telling you things that are true, but maybe it's hard to accept the fact that it comes out of this simple reasoning, but it's consistent with it. What it tells you really is that the dynamic nonlinearity in potential flow models is very weak, and unfortunately does not describe a limit cycle in transient flow. You can't use potential flow theory to get those. You do a decent job maybe getting the flutter point, but you'll never get the limit cycle. It just isn't in the model. But if you're running Navier-Stokes code, you can get a good answer for the limit cycle. And you can use harmonic balance, except that it turns out that there's some mathematical subtleties associated with using Navier-Stokes code and harmonic balance. But Professor Hall put that out a few years ago. So. But that's another story. Okay. Now I think I've told you everything I want to tell you, at least for the purpose of this course about harmonic balance. Questions? So if I ask you a question about harmonic balance, you'll be right on top of it, right? Good. And when you're in charge of some project and someone says, I think we have a limit cycle problem, and I say, it's going to take forever to do the computation. But we've got a time march and somebody's trying to sell me a code that costs millions of dollars and it's going to take a zillion days to run it. I say, well, why don't you try a harmonic balance? Then you'll earn your pay just that one day alone. Okay. All right. Let's now, 20 minutes. We've got lots of time. I'm sorry this is so small, but you've got it. Well, that's pretty real. You've got it somewhere in your email files. This is what I think you learned this past semester. Do you all agree? Oh, that's anything? Any questions? So this is why somewhere in here there'll be two or three questions I'm going to ask you about some aspects. So I might ask you about flutter and divergence. We didn't actually say a whole lot about control surface reversal, but you know the old story is that if it's not covered during the semester, we'll cover it on the final exam. So this is one of those questions. This is one of those topics that might be covered on the final exam. A gust response, we did talk about that. We talked about Lagrange's equation, Hamilton's principle. We talked about the tools of linear system dynamics. Right? We talked about and studied potential flow, both its pluses and minuses, both its good features and its limitations. To Danny's good offices, you actually were introduced to a working level code, V-Aero, and how to do a real calculation. And then we talked a little bit about harmonic balance. There are two chapters in the book, 11 and 14, that are entirely devoted to nonlinear elasticity, including harmonic balance, but including lots of other things. Okay. Last chance to ask a question. No, that's not true. You can ask a question anytime. I'm always available by email. But any of these topics, do you agree those are fair topics? Good. I'll try to think of a couple of questions between now and next week. I think that's it. It's been fun to be with you. Hope you learned something. And you'll learn more in the final exam. So will I. Okay, very good.